This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
You know, whenever I talk about horses on the radio, most of the time at least, I kind of end up waxing philosophical just a little bit about them. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for The Horse Show. I think that's kind of my nature to start with, but I just see that horses have such an amazing effect on people. They add such a level of quality, a kind of an experience that we just don't get anywhere else. And historically, of course, horses have been with the human race for about the past 6,000 years is how long they've been domesticated, and they've played such an important role in the beginning in just the survival of our species. But then as we began to thrive, the horse was a partner in all of that. And of course, today the horse isn't nearly as much a utilitarian force in our lives as kind of a qualitative thing. We have horses because they add quality to our lives, and they also enable us to get in touch with ourselves in a different way and are a vehicle for human self-development, self-improvement, helping people who need something in their lives. And I'm especially touched by some of the Wounded Warrior programs that utilize horses to help some of our brave soldiers that have been wounded in battle, physically or emotionally. And so I guess that's why I tend to kind of drift into those kind of discussions. Well, today I've got a very willing partner in crime for that. Her name is Dr. Sherry Ackerman. She is a PhD, a teacher of philosophy in college. And she's written a book called Dressage in the Fourth Dimension. We're going to touch on a lot of kind of philosophical issues about horses today. Towards the end of the program, you're going to meet Anessa Warren, who is a Monte Foreman student. The late, great Monte Foreman, he died in the mid-80s, was a very influential horseman, although most people today have never even heard his name. And one of my missions, as it is with Anessa, is to try and keep his memory alive. So we'll talk about that a little bit later in the show. Briefly, want to remind you about my website, new from the ground up, thehorseshow.com. All of our radio and TV can be accessed there, and everything is now on YouTube, so you can get it on any device. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit truevalue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit truevalue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at FarnamHorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you.
Hard work comes with a lot of sweat. That's why there's new Wrangler Cool Vantage jeans. They keep you cool by wicking sweat 5 times faster. They keep you dry by pulling moisture to the outside where it dries faster. They keep you comfortable so you're less restricted all day long. New Wrangler Premium Performance Cool Vantage jeans. The newest innovation in comfort.
And now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you today from the Western States Horse Expo in Sacramento, California. I'm Rick Lamb, and this is the Horse Show Live. My guest for this section of our show is Dr. Sherry Ackerman. Dr. Ackerman, welcome to the Horse Show.
Thank you very much, Rick. I'm happy to be here.
May I call you Sherry?
You may indeed.
I always ask. What's your PhD in?
Philosophy, and really? Your wife told me that your degree is also in philosophy.
I have a bachelor's degree. It's one of my majors when I did my bachelor's.
Do you still think philosophically?
Well, I think so.
Okay.
I'm a reflective sort of a person, and I think that's why I was drawn to philosophy in the beginning. But as a practical matter, I was studying mathematics. That was my interest. And there were so many crossover classes by virtue of logic. Logic lives in both of those fields.
Absolutely.
And I found I loved logic, the general study of logic and symbolic logic especially, which really gets into the computer field. So it all kind of meshed together for me, and I found out that I could very easily meet the requirements of both majors. So that's what I did.
Well, you're probably then in a very good position to understand what I wrote about in my book, Dressage in the Fourth Dimension, because the first chapter is about the figures that we ride in dressage, about the circles, about the squares, about the straight lines. So it's about geometry.
Oh, yeah.
And it's very much about a reflection about how those figures help the horse and rider come together in a physical and psychological balance.
Well, let's go back to set the stage a little bit for this. This Dressage in the Fourth Dimension, is this your first book? Or I'm sorry, I don't know your background very well. Have you written other books as well?
You know, I actually wrote Dressage in the Fourth Dimension in 1997. It was the first book I wrote. Yes, I have written other books since, but it was the first book I wrote. It was so far ahead of its time that it didn't really take off. But in 2008, Jack said to me, actually, Mom, it's really time to republish that book. People are there.
They're
ready for you. The publisher who was really game to move with this kind of message was New World Library.
Uh-huh.
New World Library and I came to a meeting of the minds, and it came out in this edition, which is the second edition, and Jack was right. People were really ready to hear the message now, and the message is very much about the harmony.
Mm-hmm.
Between the rider and the horse. And I have to give credit and thanks to the natural horsemanship movement for helping prepare that message. They've really tilled that ground.
Interesting. Well, you're another one of the voices that's saying, hey, dressage and natural horsemanship don't live in different worlds.
Absolutely.
They're actually very compatible.
They spring from the same source. Absolutely.
That's a good way to put it.
Yeah, and I get a little disgruntled when people say to me, oh, no, dressage is very different. And in its most formal application, of course, and natural horsemanship, in its most formal application, of course, there's differences. It's like we speak different languages as human beings, but essentially we're saying similar things.
Right. Well, and we talk about foundation principles. The best dressage masters that I know are very much aware and committed to working with the nature of the horse.
Absolutely.
And to me, that is what natural horsemanship is about. It's not this kind of superficial argument, is anything we do with a horse truly natural for them? That's to me, is a vacant argument. It just isn't important, because we know everything since domestication first began was starting to impose compromises on a horse's natural life. But if you look at the root word, nature, and figure that natural horsemanship is about the nature of the horse as a unique animal species, allowing the horse to teach us about that nature, and then committing to working within that, to me, that's at the heart of all good horsemanship and riding.
And you just hit the nail on the head of where philosophy and writing come together, because I feel that one has to be reflective, just like you offered that reflection. And I would take that to the next step and say the Latin word anima is the root of the word animal.
Oh, okay.
And the word anima, animal, means soul.
Oh.
Right. So we have, whether we recognize it or not, as human beings, a connection at the soul level, beyond the mind, you know, far beyond the ego, at the soul level with horses.
Is that different for horses, say, from dogs or other animals?
What the research seems to indicate, Rick, and I find this really interesting, is that horses have the same brainwave patterns as dolphins.
Oh.
And so in the book I'm writing now, I refer to horses as land dolphins. And we all know, the research is coming back very strong, that dolphins have a very strong resonance with the human pattern. So we have a natural affinity as human beings toward dolphins, which are harder to access, and land dolphins, horses.
Well, I'm so glad to hear that, because part of me cries out for rational explanation of this phenomenon that so far I can't explain to anybody. I mean, everybody knows, at least all of us that are involved with horses, know that they are special, that there's something about them that touches a different part of us than virtually any other animal. It may have to do with their size, it may have to do with their power, you know, the primal nature of the way they think and all of that. I don't know, but we just know it's magical. And when you get into, you know, how they can affect people with disabilities and autism
Absolutely.
And all of that, it becomes even more intriguing, and there aren't very many answers, at least that I've found so far. But we know from experience that they can change people's lives.
Absolutely.
And my first book, The Revolution in Horsemanship and What It Means to Mankind, really was an attempt to say this is much more about just a recreation, something that's fun for people to do.
Right on.
In a busy, you know, a technological era, back to nature kind of a recreation. There's something more primal and fundamental and, you know, deep reaching with horses than anything else out there. I wrote in the last chapter of the book, you may like motorcycles, but your Harley doesn't nicker to you in the morning.
Absolutely.
And that line alone seemed to resonate with a few people. I got a few Harley people that weren't too happy with me, but I think that's the point that you're speaking to.
But it gets at two points that I make in my book, and the first one being, I put forth the premise that a person can't ride any discipline, I don't care what discipline, without undergoing transformation. Sooner or later, it will get to you.
Yeah.
Even if you're the hardest, toughest, exteriorized person in the world, finally, that horse will get through to you. There's no way you can ride day after day and not change. That's point one. Point two is what they offer us is unconditionally, capital L, love. They love us no matter how many mistakes we make, no matter how bad we mess it up. They may get angry for a while, but if you're really sincerely trying to do your best, they know it, they get it, and they stand by you.
So what is the role of intention when we're working with horses? I'll ask that to Dr. Sherry Ackerman when the Horse Show Live continues. I'm Rick Lamb. Don't you dare go away. Hey, everybody. Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pen. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pen. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter in, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the five very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com.
This is Hugh Downs, and you're listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
And I'm talking with Dr. Sherry Ackerman about her book, Dressage in the Fourth Dimension.
Well, intentions seem to matter.
They totally matter.
In the horse world.
Yes.
In fact, I often wonder if that's why children seem to do better with horses and extremely elderly people.
And handicapped.
And handicapped because there's a purity of intent that maybe is lost in those of us that are kind of in the middle years where we're so focused on doing.
When we're focused on doing, we're centered in the mind. And philosophically, the mind is the ego. Mm-hmm. Horses don't want us there.
Yeah.
Anima, animal, soul. They want us in the heart.
Yeah.
And then when we drop down into the heart and all of a sudden we're like a child or we're like a handicapped person feeling that freedom perhaps in movement on the back of a horse or an elderly person remembering when a horse worked for them on the farm.
Sure.
We're in the heart and they get it.
One of the things we often talk about is you want to earn the horse's trust and you want to earn his respect. You need to have kind of both of those in equal measure. But I've also found by observing some great horsemen that they often put themselves in kind of a vulnerable position with a horse, which tells me that they are offering their trust before they expect the horse to give it back.
And I think that's the key. I'm going to tell you a story. It's actually the first chapter of the book I'm writing now, and that chapter will be called Once Upon a Lipizzan.
Yeah.
Of a horse, and I'll give you the short version. I ended up with a huge, enormous, almost 17-hand, 1,400-pound Lipizzan horse that nobody else could handle. She was headed to the killers, mean as mud. The cowboy that dropped her off looked at me and said, good luck. Good luck, Doc. I said, okay. Long story short, she's now the gentlest, sweetest horse I have. And people say, Sherry, how'd you do this? And it was just what you just said. I put it out there first. You know, I call her Lippy the Lipizzan. I intentionally put it out there to her. She would bare her teeth and go at me. She would turn her hindquarters and go after me. And I had to just keep saying, I'm going to show her what I want. I'm going to show her what I want. And that's not oosey-goosey, get-hurt kind of love. Or that's not romantic love, Hallmark love, Hollywood love. That's emptiness. In a Buddhist sense, it's emptiness. It's just being present, being right there, right now, for her.
Yeah.
And one day after another, very slowly, she began to respond. And what I learned from that experience was, in staying present, I did what a good horse would do. If I had put her out with a really wise old horse, they would have said, we don't care how mean you are. We don't care how scared you are. We're not afraid. Neither are we going to get ourselves hurt. We're just going to stand here and be present.
Yep.
And I learned how to be a horse. And there was something so powerful and so potent about that. And that's now how I approach every horse. And I work with a lot of horses. And at this point in my life, what I really enjoy, and I probably shouldn't even say this on the show because my phone will start ringing more than I need it to, but is working with problem horses. Because if you can be a horse, you can help problem horses.
Well, it's interesting you call it being a horse. I think that that kind of touches on the idea of empathy, which is a very important quality, I think. And you think about what the meaning of empathy is, and it is sort of kind of putting yourself in the other person's place, or in the case of a horse.
Right on.
It's a difficult thing to do with a different species because you can only sort of imagine from the outside how their brain works and what their view of the world really is. But even the act of doing that gets you so much closer than not doing it that it's worthwhile doing. And you mentioned also presence, and I want to comment on presence. Presence is a great word, because presence, in the sense that you talked about it, just kind of being there, being almost part of the environment.
Absolutely.
Not creating a creating a threat, but not going away either. To me, that is how I look at contact with riding a horse, is not holding on to the horse or pulling on them or anything bad, but just it's a presence that says, I'm here. And so presence seems to operate on multiple levels in working with horses.
And when you say that, and you say it really with neutrality, what you're really saying is, I'm here, and in parentheses, and I'm inviting you to be here with me. And if you can do that with a very pure heart, pretty soon the horse goes, I'll take a chance on that. Mm-hmm. And in the case of Lippy the Lipizzan, a lot of people had hurt her prior to me. She's got some big old ugly scars on her body, you know. And little by little, maybe it would be 4 seconds, she would say, I'm going to be there with you, Sherry. And I would just accept those 4 seconds. And that's contact in those 4 seconds. And that's enough for today.
Yeah.
Yeah. 4 gave way to 8 and 10.
Now, did you, when you got those 4 seconds and then the 8 and the 10 or so forth, was that when you chose to end that day's
Absolutely.
Work?
Absolutely.
Ending on a good note.
Ending on a good note. I can't tell you how many clients I have who don't really always understand that. And they'll say, hey, Sherry, I'm paying you X amount of money, and you just did 10 minutes worth of work. And I'm like, I did 10 minutes worth of work that was so good that if I try to get 2 more minutes, I'm going to diminish those 10 into 5.
You know, I've heard this said by so many great horsemen. Michael Schaefer, who's a great dressage rider, once said to me, you know, I've never regretted stopping too early. I've regretted many times going
too long. Me too.
And there's another thing about that idea of ending on a good note. Tom Dorrance,
one of my heroes,
natural horsemanship, is reputed to have said that if you can end on a good note, your horse will be that good or better the next time. If you end on a bad note, he'll almost certainly be worse when you take him up again. And I said that once in a lecture at an event in, I think, Pomona, actually. And there's a great trainer in this area named Ray Aris that is a dressage rider. And he also kind of made his name in training a Mustang named Hale Yeah, kind of turned him into a beautiful dressage horse. And he was in the audience, and he raised his hand and said, Rick, I'm sorry, but I don't agree with that. And I thought, oh, boy, what did I say now?
He
said, okay, Ray, what do you mean? He said, I think they'll be 5 times better.
Right on.
So it's hard to overstate the importance of that moment and being open to it and ready for it when it comes and being willing to change in an instant your plan for the rest of the day.
And I think the other piece of that, I agree with everything you've said, and I think I'll add a piece to it, is that it's not about what I want, but really about what the horse wants, because dressage is very demanding physically on the horse. It's very physical, and it requires a lot of strength. And the horse may come to me not quite prepared enough to do a full session, to do a full 45 minutes worth of work or an hour worth of work. And I may ride for 20 minutes, and I feel that sweet acceptance in the horse's body. And it's not just the mind, it's the horse's body. And I'm like, that's it. Because if I go another 5 minutes, that horse is going to be sore.
My guest is Dr. Sherry Ackerman, author of Dressage in the Fourth Dimension. And when we get back, we'll talk a little bit about her thoughts on horse keeping. This is The Horse Show, live from the Western States Horse Expo. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit truevalue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit truevalue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Thank you, Woodman. We are back, everybody. My guest is Dr. Sherry Ackerman. We've been talking about her book, Dressage in the Fourth Dimension. What are your thoughts, Sherry, about how we keep horses?
You know, I had at one time a huge stall barn, indoor arena, carefully groomed paddocks. And what I learned observing horses is my horses want to be outdoors.
Oh, yes.
So since I moved to California from Vermont, which has a very different kind of climate, I built my entire facility to be an outdoor facility.
Oh, good
Fantastic.
For you.
They all have individual shelters, but it's in and out at their own pleasure. Washing is totally optional. If it's a horse that kind of likes to splash and play in the water, that's available. But if it's a horse that just wants to go roll, hey, there you go. They can get turned out and just roll. Really allowing my horses to be horses, and they are happy.
When we take out the human influence and they're allowed to make their own choices, what choices do they make? Well, that ought to tell you what's important to them.
I live in Mount Shasta, where we often get snow in the winter. It's in the Cascade Mountains. And my horses will stand out, three and four, they have a, you know, a blanket on, but 3 or 4 inches of snow, fluffy white snow, will build up on their backs, and they look so happy. And then when they're tired of it, they'll shake it off and walk into their shelters.
Yeah.
It's just a natural part of their rhythm, and I've really learned from that.
Yeah. Well, that's fantastic. Well, is the fourth dimension the soul in your book?
The fourth dimension is the soul, and it's the soul expressed by, and I keep saying capital L, love.
Okay.
So it's not love, again, in a Hallmark Hollywood kind of way, but it's that kind of love that stand by me.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Partnership.
Fantastic.
Real partnership.
Well, the other thing I like about your book, and this may seem like a small thing, but I think it's important to how people perceive of books and other things, is it's a small physical book.
Right on.
It fits easily in your hand. It's what, about maybe a half an inch thick. It's not an intimidating read. And I think every book that I write from now on is going to be of that size. And I would rather write two books of that size than one that's a big book that people are afraid to pick up. Because that, now you're an intellectual, you're an academic. I'm sure you read voraciously. I do the same thing, but a lot of people don't.
And it's also, if I could say so myself, New World Library did a beautiful job with it. It's beautiful. It's a pretty book to
it
look
is.
At.
It's a very pretty book.
And the message is about the soul, and it's about Big L love. Yeah. So it needs to be pretty.
Fantastic. Well, I didn't ask you, do you teach? Are you affiliated with a university?
Absolutely. I teach at College of the Siskiyous, and I teach philosophy there.
Fantastic.
As well as teaching this work, I put together, Rick, a workshop that I call Dressage in the Fourth Dimension Workshop, which incorporates, it's pretty neat, it incorporates dressage. So every day the riders are riding, yoga, we do yoga together, meditation, so we work with our minds, and psychology. We talk about what comes up for us when we ride at the level of anger, frustration, lack of confidence, and what kinds of things we can constructively do about that.
Interesting, you bring up the emotions, and I wanted to kind of maybe go out on this thought and get your feelings on it. In my experience, emotions quite often interfere with building a relationship with a horse. In other words, and almost any emotion you can think of. Certainly anger, certainly revenge or fear. And I would say that even inappropriately expressed affection,
I agree,
carried too far, those things kind of don't work in the horse's world very well.
And they don't work among people either. And if we can learn that with horses, we can also relate better to one another as human beings.
Well, I'm glad you said that, because that opened the door to another whole thought. I mean, how do you draw that parallel to improving human-to-human relationships?
One of the things I do in this workshop that I call a dressage in the fourth dimension, and it's a four-day workshop, and I've been doing that all over the U.S., and I'm on my way to Norway and Denmark and Sweden to do some there as well. But I start by using important thinkers in that area, and primarily I use someone called Karen Horney, who wrote in the 1930s and had some very interesting things to say about that. So I have people work with their horses during the day, mm-hmm. and I watch what comes up, and I make a note of it and just mm-hmm. watch it. Then we have a session. We sign a confidentiality statement so we feel safe with one another. Then I have a session with small groups of riders, and I say, what came up for you with your horse? Some are very self-aware, and they know.
Uh-huh.
If they are, I seize the moment, and I say, does that ever come up with you and your children?
Oh.
Does that ever come up with you and your partner? And if they're very self-aware and open, they'll come with that. If they're not so self-aware, I'll try to gently lead them and say, one thing I think I noticed that came up with you and your horse was maybe a certain lack of assertiveness.
Uh-huh.
Can you agree that that might have come up?
Yeah.
And if they can, we can go a little further. And if they can't, we leave it there.
Sure.
It's okay. But then I carefully ask them, that's something I'd like to ask you to look for also with your loved ones. Are there times with your neighbors or with your boss that you'd like to ask for something that you don't ask for?
Uh-huh.
And we use a workbook. And the workbook has these exercises they do that ask them to connect those dots. And what I find happening is, as they do this more holistically, with horses, with humans, mm-hmm. with dogs,
right.
they start to discover themselves. And they start to discover who they are versus perhaps who they want to be.
Interesting.
And they start to walk more toward who they want to be and not feel so stuck in who they thought they were, which was really just a moment in time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are most of your workshops with women?
Yes.
Do you find that it creates a safer and more conducive environment for really being honest when you separate the genders?
Absolutely. I have, in fact, made it a policy in the last 3 years. I used to teach a few men, and they found it just very, very different. The male psyche is a little bit different than the feminine psyche.
I think it's a lot different.
I would agree. I was being tactful.
Okay. Well, it's neat to me that in this day and age, we've come almost full circle in the sense that we're no longer buying into this nonsense that men and women are the same. They are fundamentally different.
Absolutely.
And it's yin and yang. It's what, you know, hot and cold. It's whatever you want to call it, the complementary forces in the
right.
universe. And if they were not different, life would not work.
Right.
So, I'm a student of learning, as you are, and I think that it's absolutely undeniable that men and women learn differently. They process things differently. and their ego works in different ways.
Totally different.
And so trying to be all things to all people in a learning environment, sometimes you run flat into a brick wall that way, and you can't be anything to anybody.
And it just becomes inappropriate. In this particular workshop, the Dressage in the Fourth Dimension workshop, I actually use mythology to open up consciousness. And for example, I feel myths that best represent the male psyche would be like Parsifal's search for the Holy Grail. Now, for a woman, that myth has absolutely no relevance.
Right.
So I use the myths of Psyche and Aphrodite and the Handless Maiden. And all of a sudden, these women start going, oh, I can find myself in that.
Yes.
Whereas men would say, what are you talking about? You know? So by gender separating the workshops, the level of accelerated growth has exponentially improved.
Equal and equivalent are two different concepts mathematically and I think even in life. And so we can always say men and women should be equivalent in everything that they do, have all the same opportunities, but it doesn't mean that they're equal in the sense of
they're not the same. They're not the same.
Yeah.
I am not as strong physically as you are. Just the way we're hardwired in terms
sure.
of hormones and chemicals.
Absolutely.
If my suitcase is loaded to the gills with a bunch of these books for the expo, I'm going to say, hey, Rick, can you give me a hand?
Sure.
On the other hand, I may have much greater sensitivities in being able, for example, to read somebody's body language or something.
Absolutely.
Than you would, and it would be appropriate for you to say to me, sure, what kind of vibe are you getting off that person over there? And I might pick something up.
Yeah.
And that whole thing about women's intuition, I really think is pretty valid.
I do too. And you know, there's probably, you could probably look back in the grand design of things and see why that was important.
Absolutely.
I mean, women had different roles, and certainly in raising children. And well, you are such a delight and an absolute surprise to me. I knew of you, but I had no idea that we would connect in the way we did. I want to be sure we allow folks to learn more about your book. Buy it if they are so inclined.
Absolutely.
Go ahead and give me the pitch. Where can they learn more about it?
They can learn more about it on my website, which is www.dressageinthefourth. All spelled out. dressageinthefourth.com.
.com. All right. My guest has been Dr. Sherry Ackerman, Doctor of Philosophy. Thank you for being my guest today on the Horse Show.
I really enjoyed it. I have such a sense that our heads are in the same place, and I feel like I'm talking to a real fellow traveler.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rick.
You know, his name may not mean too much to you, but Monte Foreman was a very important horseman. When we get back, Anessa Warren will join me to talk about how she is trying to keep his memory alive in her work. Stay with us.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
Cowboy Dressage has rocked the horse world. See what all the excitement is about November 5th through 8th at the Cowboy Dressage World Gathering and Finals in Rancho Murrieta, California. Cowboy Dressage combines the best of Western and English riding disciplines with a commitment to kindness. And at this year's finals, there's a top hand competition where anything could happen. The Cowboy Dressage World Gathering and Finals, November 5th through 8th at the Rancho Murrieta Equestrian Center. Learn more at cowboydressageworld.com.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. Top farriers, researchers, and veterinarians are coming together in Las Vegas December 3rd through 5th for the International Lameness Prevention Conference, and you're invited. Learn about the latest research on causes of lameness, state-of-the-art treatment protocols, and most important, how we can manage our horses to promote healthy hooves. The International Lameness Prevention Conference during the NFR in Las Vegas, December 3rd through 5th, brought to you by the Equine Lameness Prevention Organization. For more information, visit ilpc.info. The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you from the Western States Horse Expo in Sacramento. This is The Horse Show Live, and I'm your host, Rick Lamb. I'm with Anessa Warren. Anessa, welcome to The Horse Show.
Thank you, Rick.
What kind of horses do you train?
Well, I train any kind of horses. I'm a third-generation Monte Foreman horse trainer.
Really?
Yes.
I'm a big fan of Monte Foreman.
You and me both.
I did a TV episode about him, and you know, his son Gary just passed away recently.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yes, he did, just within the last couple months. And have talked to a number of his proteges, and really, one of my missions in life is trying to keep his memory alive, if at all possible. So when you say third generation, does that mean your parent? And
well, actually what I mean is there was Monty, and then he trained Pat Weiss. He trained John Bozanich, who I've both followed through the years. So now I've never met Monty Foreman myself personally,
right.
But I trained.
Well, he's been dead for 20 some years, so.
Well, I'm old enough to know that.
Yeah. So Boz is the guy that you learned from?
And Pat Weiss,
yeah. Well, fantastic. I can't pass up a chance to talk to you about Monty Foreman's riding techniques and saddle design and so forth. How would you describe that to somebody who'd never heard of Monty Foreman?
That's a good question. In my opinion, Monty Foreman covers everything. He covers dressage, endurance, reining, cutting, trail, all of it. He's into the versatile horse. And he was a more proactive rider. He wasn't reactive. He was more into learn how to work with the horse. Don't wait for the horse to do something. And then by the time you wait for that to happen, it's too late. You're in a wreck. And that's probably the best way, in my opinion, that you can describe his type of riding style, because he didn't really care about the saddle per se, even though he does have his own saddle style, which I think is wonderful. But he just covered everything, and that's what was really intriguing to me, because my background is jumpers. I rode jumpers as a little girl.
He jumped horses too,
but my training was how to look good on a horse. It wasn't training the horse to do what it was supposed to do. And I went to a Boz clinic quite a few years ago, and you can't get me out of the arena now. I mean, yeah. I just love it. I just love the whole stopping, turning them around, and being more proficient at your ability to ride.
You know, Monty put it all into what he called the basic handle, which I believe was 13, is that correct? 13 exercises?
Uh-huh.
And a lot of them, as you mentioned, have to do with stopping and turning a horse around. And either, you know, taking off on the same lead or a different lead or whatever it may be. Why do you think that he put so much emphasis on that particular maneuver?
it takes timing. I mean, it really, you have to actually pay attention and learn your balance and learn the feel of the horse.
Can you do all 13 of those?
Yes, I can.
All right. Was that hard to learn?
It was hard, but it was worth every minute of it. Yeah. I mean, I have no regrets. The time I've spent, you know, driving to go take a lesson that was 5 hours away from my house.
Wow.
and doing that type of stuff. So I can't say enough about the system, and it's my intention to keep it going.
Good for you. I'm always happy to hear that. So was Pat or Boz kind of your primary mentor?
Both of them were. Boz offered me something different than Pat did, and both of them, I've combined both of what they've showed me into kind of my own little technique. And what I mean by technique is you don't have to spend hours and hours and hours out there riding your horse. I work a regular job for a living.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm very proficient at my riding ability. And that was another thing that was very attractive to me with the Monte Foreman style, was that you didn't have to spend a whole bunch of time riding in the arena trying to learn how to do it. It was very simple.
Mm-hmm.
But you just had to know how to get the right coaching on how to do the maneuvers. And that's what was great for me.
Have you gone back to those old Monte films?
I have them all.
You do?
I have them all. I even have some of students at some of his clinics that he's taught. I have quite a few of them, believe it or not.
So you've got the way he taught it as well as the way your direct mentors taught it.
Right. I have both.
Yeah.
And I've also thrown in my own little style. Just because...
Well, everybody kind of does that. I mean, you have to make it your own.
Right, but I still want to give credit to
the
people
that
taught me.
While we're talking about Monte, you mentioned saddle. The Monte Foreman Balanced Ride saddle, to me, was a, you know, groundbreaking development in saddle design. Do you ride that kind of a saddle?
Absolutely.
Describe that, the design of that saddle, what makes it different from a standard Western saddle.
I would say the rigging. You start with the rigging. The stirrups are hung more forward, more like a jump saddle. It doesn't have the big hump in the front, so it's more in a bareback position. So it makes you more balanced on the back of the horse, and it just fits better for the human to be in tune with the horse.
The greatest, I have one as well, although mine was made by John Fallis. In the old days, Monte and his parents were partners and made those original ones, so it's essentially the same probably as the Foreman that you've had. But the key thing to me about that design, all the other things you said are absolutely true, but I would focus in on the way that front cinch works, the way the latigo is spread out,
right,
so that you don't have this lump that builds up under your leg.
The rigging.
Huge thing to me. And even if I were to ride a different saddle that was designed differently in other respects, I mean, I don't think I would ever go back to a different kind of a cinching mechanism, because that fanned out latigo makes it so much better for your knees. It's more comfortable, closer contact. And I look at pictures of myself riding that saddle, and my leg looks like it's right on the horse's side.
Yes, I would agree.
And that's not the case sometimes. I mean, as Monte talked about, sometimes those in the old days, they would have, you know, the thickness of a 2x4 or even a 4x4 under their knee, and hard on the knees, and you don't feel the horse very well.
Right, and it sends you forward to the other styles of Western saddles, I would say.
Well, it's so neat to meet you.
Well, thank you, Rick.
And learn that you have a similar interest to mine in Monte Foreman. My guest has been Anessa Warren. Her website is gotnoflies.com. You want to see an innovative fly control mechanism, go there and check that out. Anessa, thanks for being with us today.
Thank you, Rick.
You know, Anessa mentioned a couple of her mentors in learning the Monte Foreman work, and I'd like to give you some more information on that. She mentioned Boz. That's John Bozanich. His website is bozsaddlery.com, B-O-Z, saddlery.com. She also mentioned Patrick Wise. Pat Wise's website is horsewise.com. That's W-Y-S-E. I'd like to add to that, because he was so instrumental in the TV episode that we did on Monte Foreman, Ron McLaughlin, who runs the McLaughlin Horse Handling School in Arizona. Best way to locate him is just to Google his name, Ron McLaughlin, and it's spelled a little differently than it sounds, so listen carefully, McLaughlin. Now, we were also talking there about Monte Foreman's basic handle, which is how he organized what he taught.
He felt that there were 13 move basics that people needed to master to really be able to ride well. And we covered these in depth on the TV show, and were able to use some of Pat Wise's video to demonstrate them. And I think we presented it about as well as it could be done. It's a pretty difficult thing, I think, to talk about without at least seeing it in video form. But I'm going to at least mention to you these 13 descriptors. And this is the way Monte described them. Starts with the turn on the forehand, then the side pass, leads, posting at the trot and the natural depart to the correct lead, the drop to trot lead change, the natural flying lead change, balanced stops, the roll away from the lead, the same lead roll and out the opposite lead, also known as the same and out, the same lead roll, the 360 degree roll, the 180 degree roll to the correct lead, and spins. Now, already you're probably confused. I don't blame you one little bit. When he talks about rolls, it's basically what we have in reining is a roll back, where the horse, you know, comes to a stop, kind of sucks back on his hocks, lifts his front end, and swings around and takes off in another direction. That's what Monte called a roll. But it was very important to Monte that you have control over what lead the horse took off on. If you came in on one lead and you rolled back one direction, which lead are you going to? Is he going to go back into his canter on or his lope? Is he going to go on the same lead, the direction that he turned? That would be the easiest thing to do. But what if he turned one direction, you wanted him to go on the opposite lead and taking off? You could see that you'd have to have your balance and your cues with your horse and all of this, your position in the saddle, really, really together to make that even possible for the horse. So it's a pretty subtle thing and definitely worth looking into. Fortunately, Monte was an avid filmer. He filmed everything back in the era of the 16 and 8mm actual film that had to be developed and played back on a projector. He was able to piece together these composite films that he would play at his clinics for people. And fortunately, before they were completely worn out, they were transferred to video, and they are available today in DVD form. There are three of them, along with a book that Monte Foreman wrote with Patrick Wise called Monte Foreman's Horse Handling Science, or Horse Training Science. I'm not sure which one it is. Anyway, all of those resources, the book and all three videos, are available at videohorse.com. Now, this is a wonderful resource, a website that has all kinds of videos related to horse training, horse breeds, horsemen, including the late, great Monte Foreman, operated by my friend Dr. Mike Garner, videohorse.com. Don't forget our website, thehorseshow.com, new from the ground up. It is a great portal to our YouTube channel where you have access to all of our TV and radio content. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.